Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I'd like to welcome everyone to our March 21st meeting of the Alamance County Commissioners. At this time, I'd ask Vice Chair Boswell if he'd do our invocation.
Let's bow our heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for a beautiful day today. Thank you for the reminder of spring and what you've given us and your son. Dear God, be with us as we go through the Easter season this week, and just let us remember what that's all about. Thank you for all the people who showed up here tonight to talk, and ones that are here just to listen as to what we do, and help us to make the right decisions for our county. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen. Please stand for a pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Please be seated. All right. We have, members, we have two public speakers tonight. First one will be Mr. Joe Tickle. Welcome, sir.
I come here tonight to talk to you about your raising the fund balance three times what the state requires. I just want to let you know it's a whole lot, and you already know, I guess, that it's a whole lot easier to waste money when you got it than it is if you don't have it. If you don't have the money, then you might take a second look at something. Somebody comes and wants something. So you probably need to back off on that. And if you got extra money that you need to put in the fund, that you got no place to put it, then give it back to the rightful owner, the taxpayer. Second thing we'll talk about is hiring these outside attorneys. Next time y'all hire an attorney, would you please ask him, can he defend the county in a courtroom? Because this is getting expensive. Years ago, we had a county attorney that he couldn't defend anything the county, every time the county got sued, he couldn't defend him. And then they started bullying our sheriff around, and then all of a sudden, he becomes an expert. Same guy. Now, what's up with that? Who determines who the expert is? And not too long ago, we had a county attorney, and if you sued the county, he defended them in courtroom, and he's sitting on the board tonight. Y'all have a good day, and if I can yield my time, since he whines all the time, to Tony.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you, Mr. Tickle. Thank you, Joe. All right, Tony Cox.
So this means I get like 4.5 minutes?
Yeah.
Thank you, Joe. Joe's got all kind of money. He can afford it. Keep on. You pick up your A game a little bit, Joe. Everything'll be all right. Well, I'll tell you what, I wish I was paying hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of taxes. I honestly wish I was. But hey, who cares, right? You know, talking about these attorneys, though, the more I talk to lawyers, the more they say, well, you know, that ain't my expertise. I don't know what you're calling me for. I'm a real estate lawyer. Well, you got out of the real estate business and started opening your mouth in other people's business instead of just real estate, doing closings and stuff. But it's funny how people can be bullies and get away with it and this and that and the other. And us, the people, when we're trying to file these complaints and stuff, boy, just it takes forever, it seems like, or not at all. But, you know, with the internet the way it is now, they're making it easier on the internet to where you can file your own lawsuits, and it don't cost but $120. I heard a man talking about it on the radio. He said that these lawyers messed up in getting him evicted, and he said that that person went out and got them somebody else, and now they're coming back at it with a second stand. They're going to get him. This election stuff, I kind of thought Joe was going to stop from the podium here a little bit, but rule number 7 says you can't do that, even though some people do it, but that's okay, I guess, if you're a Republican. I know some people that are unaffiliated voters. They would like to put their hat into the ring, but we all know that that's unfair, and the county attorney, he can't answer that question because that's outside the scope of what he does. That's what the newspaper said, I think. But maybe we'll get it worked out one of these days. I seen that over there in Iraq, some more of the U.S. military guys got killed again over that boondoggle. All them trillions of dollars been wasted over there. They could have been used here. Education's destroyed all over the country. Everybody's talking about world-class schools. That's a joke, ain't it? Look how stupid we've gotten. Donald Trump running for president, fights everywhere. But that didn't just start. That's been going on for a long time. And you know, my people that done that Constitution thing, they said, if you see something wrong, get to the tallest trees and scream, scream, scream. And I do it. I do it every time I get a chance, whether it's the radio, TV, internet, I don't care. But maybe the Democrats, they might be able to put up a fight to where they could get at least two seats, but I know that we can't sign in, write down names, because they don't allow that with county commissioners. But we're fighting about all these, Democrats, these others talking about IDs and stuff. Let's get it where unaffiliated voters can get on that ticket.
Thank you, Mr. Cox. There is a way, I guess we get a commissioner's comments, mm-hmm. I'll start. To answer your question, there is a way they have to get so many signatures.
Thousands.
Yeah, and,
that ain't fair. And
to get on the ballot, and my understanding, I'd heard five or six names mentioned this year, people that once they found out what they had to do, that they it stopped them from running for different offices, not just county commissioner, but different offices. Any comments from commissioners? I kind of jumped the gun.
Well, I wanted to respond just a minute to Mr. Tickle, and I appreciate you coming to make your remarks. My view is that we need to exercise good business practices in our county government, and that having an adequate fund balance is a good business practice. And while the state might require only 8%, counties our size normally have 25% fund balances, or 26 or so, I think. Susan, what was it? It was 26.
26.
When we voted on this at the last meeting, I mentioned the fact that where I used to work at Alamance Regional, we maintained a fund balance of in excess of 40% of our annual operating costs. And a strong balance sheet, not only does it enable us to take care of emergencies that come up, but when we need, when things do come up, like when we put the roof on the jail, we didn't have to go borrow money and then incur extra interest expense. And it's also, it keeps our interest rates down if we do have to borrow money, because nobody wants to lend money to an organization that doesn't already have good financial strength. And one of the key indicators of financial strength is that fund balance that is kept in an organization. I mean, we can look at that again, it's always open to discussion, but that 8% is just a bare minimum. And when we got down to that level before I got on the board, I understand that we were getting letters from the local government commission, and we were kind of in hot water at that point.
Thank you. Mr. Bird, any other comments?
Well, I mean, I don't mind talking about it again. I think we can put this on our agenda to discuss. I mean, in looking at our agenda tonight, we do have the funding of the ACC bond that we've got to look at. And I think we need to take that into consideration because, yes, we may have to use some of that fund balance to fund something that's already been done, right? Yeah. That's just my thoughts.
That's where we come
from. So, I mean, I don't mind putting it on the agenda. I don't think we should do anything different tonight, but at least discuss it and kind of look at some of our future needs to project and see what we might be able to do.
Any further? I only had one question, Joe, when we approved that, and it was this, that will this help to improve our bond rating? which currently is AA minus. Mm-hmm. And it could possibly help. They look, that is one thing that they do look at, you know, when you're talking about that. And by doing that, if we go back to a, say, a AAA where it's a AA minus, it could be a tremendous savings when you're looking at our bond rating. So that's what I was looking at. Any further comments? Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. Approval of the agenda. Members, any questions on the agenda that's before us tonight? Do I have a motion to approve of the agenda?
Motion to approve.
I have a second.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Consent agenda. Members, I hope you've had time to look over. Is any items to be pulled from the consent agenda? Hearing none, do I have a motion that we approve the consent agenda?
So move.
Second.
All right, have a motion and second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. All right, next we have, members, I'd like to move up one item. Item number 9, proclamation for County Day of Recognition for National Service. If you can tell my voice, I just hope you get through the meeting tonight. And we've got two proclamations, so I'm going to do one at the beginning and one at the end. And we also have Mr. Tim Jeffers here. Mr. Jeffers, I'd ask you to come up front to the podium, please. And this is for proclamation for National Service Recognition Day.
Yes, sir.
And sir, with your permission, I'll sit here and read this and then let you make any comments you'd like to make. Whereas service to others is a hallmark of the American character and central to how we meet our challenges. Whereas the nation's counties are increasingly turning to the national service and volunteerism as a cost-effective strategy to meet county needs. And whereas AmeriCorps and Senior Corps participants address the most pressing challenges facing our communities, from educating students for the jobs of the 21st century and supporting veterans and military families to providing health services and helping communities recover from national disasters. And whereas national service expands economic opportunity by creating more sustainable, resilient communities and providing education, career skills, and leadership abilities for those who serve. And whereas AmeriCorps and Senior Corps participants serve in more than 60,000 locations across the country, bolstering the civic, neighborhood, and faith-based organizations that are so vital to our economic and social well-being. And whereas national service participants increase the impact of the organizations they serve, both through their direct service and by managing millions of additional volunteers. Whereas national service represents a unique public-private partnership that invests in community solutions and leverages non-federal resources to strengthen community impact and increase the return on taxpayer dollars. And whereas national service participants demonstrate commitment, dedication, and patriotism by making an intensive commitment to service, a commitment that remains with them in their future endeavors. And whereas the Corporation for National and Community Service shares a priority with county executives nationwide to engage citizens, improve lives, and strengthen communities, and is joining with the National Association of Counties and County Executives across the county for the County Day of Recognition for National Service on April 7, 2016. Therefore, be it resolved that we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim April 7, 2016 as National Service Recognition Day and encourage residents to recognize the positive impact of national service in our county, to thank those who serve, and to find ways to give back to their community. Signed this 21st day of March, Dan Engel, Chairman, Tory Frank, Clerk to the Board. Sir, I'd like to congratulate you and thank you.
Accepting
this, we'll take some word from
you. Thank you. Yes, sir.
On behalf of Corporation of National Community Services, I'd like to thank you guys for the proclamation, and we'll be contacting your office shortly, and we'd ask that you guys register as they like for the elected officials and county commissioners to sign up all across the nation for the National Day of Service. So again, we thank you.
Explain that to
AmeriCorps. Corporation for National Corporation for National Service has several different entities. AmeriCorps, Senior Corps. My particular program is RSVP, which is Retired Senior Volunteer Program, mm-hmm. where I go out and I actively recruit volunteers age 55 years and older to get involved in the school system, or we also have a program called Respite Care. people that sit at home all day. Our volunteers go in and relieve them a couple hours a week, or, you know, however they agreed upon. So Alamance County has a lot of volunteers that help make Alamance County the good county that it is.
Well, good. Thank you for your service.
We sort of appreciate it, Mr. Jefferson. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Just by
discontent.
Yeah. Appreciate it, sir. All right. Next, we have going back to the to our agenda, item number one and under seven, ABS lottery funds request, Jay Fuller and Jimmy Russell, the facilities operations. Welcome, sir.
Hey.
Thank you.
Jay.
Thank you. I'm just wanting to see if we could get approval on the lottery money for the painting of five schools, the entire school. Grove Park Elementary, Southern High, Western High, Western Middle, and Woodlawn Middle.
All right, sir. Any questions?
No, I was going to say that I was at the school board meeting when that was discussed at the work session, and it all seemed to be very much in order, and it was good questions asked and answers.
And the total request is $739,329.
From the lottery.
Is that painting inside?
It's inside and out.
It's
a total paint.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, if I could say, they currently have about $3.5 million in lottery funds, and taking off the $750,000 will leave them about $2.8 million in lottery funds.
Any further questions?
I'll make the motion.
Motion
for approval and second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. All right. Next, we have the request for funding for legal counsel, Board of Elections. Doug Finn Cannon, Board Chairman, is not here. Mr. Honeycutt, you need to address the board.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Finn Cannon has asked that I make this presentation for him on behalf of the Board of Elections. This is something they have requested. It's not something Clyde or our legal department has requested. This is a direct funding request from the Board of Elections. One of the things that we have found out, and the Board of Elections have found out, that the State Attorney General's office is not giving a lot of free legal advice anymore. They have basically told Board of Elections to go out and get your own attorney. And they have recommended that we hire Mr. Donald M. Wright from Apex. We would give him a retainer of $2,500 and then pay him on an as-needed basis. And we would put in an additional $2,500 into the budget, so they'd have a $5,000 legal line item that they don't have now. Our attorney has stated that he was fine with what they were doing, but again, this is a request from the Board of Elections.
All right. Any questions?
Our attorney, Mr. Albright, is okay with this, is what you said?
As long as they're not suing the county, we're okay with this. So, one of the things that we do have in the resolution is that before they enter into any lawsuit, they do have to consult with our county attorney.
The State Board of Election has their own attorney that advises the State Board of Election.
Right.
If a county Board of Election finds itself on the wrong end of a lawsuit, the Attorney General may defend it.
But this is something that you wouldn't normally represent.
Well, it is, but we have in the resolution that they will enter into the defense with the advice and consent of the Board of Commissioners and the County Attorney's Office.
Does members have a copy of this before we?
Yeah, we just got it tonight. Okay. So
let me go ahead and if I lose my voice, you take over. But I'll go ahead and read this and make it part of the record, public record, and then we can decide whether we want to do this resolution. This was prepared by Mr. Albright and approved by their chair.
Met with Mr. Finn Cannon this afternoon.
Yeah, Mr. Finn Cannon to bring to us resolution create line item in the Alamance County Board of Elections budget to provide for legal counsel to the County Board of Elections. Whereas Alamance County Board of Elections has expressed a desire to engage services of Donald Wright Esquire, 4804 Hollybrook Drive, Apex, North Carolina, provide legal updates and consulting services regarding North Carolina election law to the Alamance County Board of Elections. Whereas General Statute 153A971 authorized the county pursuant to GS 168-167 to provide for the defense of the County Board of Elections. Whereas Alamance County adopts its uniform standards for claims against employees, officers, and officials on September 14, 1987, and such uniform standards remain in force and effect. And whereas the authorized scope of work calls for Wright to provide legal updates and consulting services pertaining to North Carolina election law is requested by the Alamance County Board of Elections from time to time. Whereas in providing these services to the Board of Elections of Alamance County, Wright shall consult with the Alamance County Attorney and Alamance County Board of County Commissioners before any litigation action is taken, and shall have no authority to bind the county or the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. Whereas the Board of Elections of Alamance County has requested the addition of the line item, which I didn't state, is 110-4170-190, professional services line item, to the budget of the Board of Elections of Alamance County, and further requests the amount of $5,000 to be transferred to 110-4170-241 to 110-4170-190 for the purposes of paying for these professional services. Now therefore be it resolved that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners hereby approves for the legal representation of the Alamance County Board of Elections by Donald Wright Esquire a line item for that particular line item, professional services to the budget of the Board of Elections of Alamance County shall be added, and further that the amount of $5,000 shall be transferred to those line items for the purpose of paying for the professional services. So that's what we're voting on, members. Any further discussion?
Yeah, I can't agree to this. This is nothing but more bureaucracy, and I think it came about because that Attorney General we've got down there has had trouble with the Republican legislature, and he is kind of blaming a lot of the local governments for sending the Republican legislature down there, and I think it's something that's absolutely unnecessary. And we've got too many people wanting lawyers. By the way, I'm not a lawyer anymore.
You can speak that now, yeah. Right?
I think I heard that tonight, I believe, one time before, if I'm not mistaken.
Just go on the internet and do it.
And,
I don't disagree with what Commissioner Smith just said. I know in my experience during my career that attorneys have become so specialized in speaking to Mr. Tickle's comments earlier that it's kind of like medicine that, you know, you don't go to your cardiologist if you have an orthopedic problem or even a pulmonary problem. And but I don't know if that really applies in this particular situation or not.
All that means is the lawyer who's not a specialist in Board of Elections or Board of Education doesn't have to read up on it and do a little research. Otherwise, they are able to do it just like anybody else in the Board of Education. I can't believe they go to Raleigh to pick up some high expensive law firm down there when we had good local lawyers doing it here for years and years. And I think most counties do have their own local lawyers representing them on their Board of Education. But there again, I'm not on the Board of Education and I have no control over what they do, and I certainly don't want any control over what they do.
What's the purpose of having the retainer? I don't really understand why we need to retain an attorney if we're not in a legal issue.
There was some research done on that, and it went from some counties. I think it was, 16 or 17 counties had hired this one.
From what we've been told, Mr. Wright worked in the Attorney General's office.
He was a Board of Elections General Counsel.
Board of Elections General Counsel. He has retired from that position. And he is going around, and I guess his second career is working with boards of elections, and he's only keeping a certain number of counties that on retainer, so he's not doing this. You know, if you're on retainer, you know, you have him. So that he will also provide what we've been told is legal updates. So if there's changes to the election law or like a listserv, that he would provide email and updates to the Board of Elections as part of that retainer fee. That's my understanding.
So I guess the question is, and I know Doug would have been here if he'd been asked, but if the Board of Elections has a question, a legal question, in the past they've been going to through the State Board of Elections and their legal counsel.
Most of the time they call me.
And that has stopped now. They have ceased.
Last week I got several calls. As I understand, this service is to tap into his 30-some years of knowledge as an attorney for the Board of Elections.
He's the guy who used to advise them when they had a question.
All right. Any further questions? All right. No further discussion. Do I have a motion for approval? I'd say that this issue's dead for lack of a motion for approval. All right. Thank you. Next, we'll go to New State Farm Park proposal for Austin Court Lake. Mike Holland, you have a 10-minute presentation, sir, I understand.
I'll try to keep it to 10.
Well, we're going to make sure you do.
Five of you and one of me.
You're on the clock.
You got your help. Thank you for your time on your agenda to share with
can
you.
Y'all, can you shut maybe one light off so we can see the board a little better? There you go. That's good. Oops. That's good.
Well, first of all, thank you for your time on your agenda. I'm going to share with you a proposal from my board, our series board of directors. Empowered a tourism protection committee about a decade ago, and they've requested me to ask of the county commissioners to convene an oversight committee to design and implement a new type of state farm park. There's a unique model here in the entire state of North Carolina, so this is a very exciting project for me. In addition, they'd like to consider asking you to fund a feasibility study to determine the return on investment, the generation of ecotourism-based revenue for the county. And as you know, large state-funded parks are an economic positive to the host counties. I think there's a clicker here. Whoops. And just to start off with, we're, as you know, in the center of the economic arch of North Carolina. Here's the location of the proposed park, 1,100 acres down here in the corner, southern corner of the county, 11 miles from where we're sitting here, also 11 miles from Carrboro, 12 miles from Chatham Park down in Pittsburgh, we'll get to that, and then more importantly, only 11 miles from the interstate. And here's the actual site map. The proposed state park, 1,100 acres, borders Orange County. It's next to the landfill. Importantly, it borders the landfill, 3/4 mile border, the Haw River, 2 miles of water frontage. And it's only a mile from the top corner by road to Saxbaugh. Here's Saxbaugh Hall Mill, the corner of the mill here. The strengths of this project, of course, are location. The location at the center of 66% of North Carolina's tourist target audience. The other strength is the people of Alamance County. They've demanded more park and trails in the 2003 generated 2020 plan. If you remember back, that was one of the main things they asked for and one of the main things the county got a report card back up, A+, after 10 years. So in addition, we're hearing back from the strategic plan that's being put together now that they want park and trails. So the people of Alamance are a huge strength. The county staff, they've been focused for the past decade on passive parks and trails, and they're currently looking to develop a park in the southern part of the county. The Haw River Trail and the Mountains to Sea Trail are a great strength for this project. Bruce Cameron family, sorry, the Saxbaugh, sorry, the customer base has been is a great strength for this project. Saxbaugh has been training the customer base of tourists for the last 15 years and bringing our brand of sustainable ecotourism to that target audience. The stakeholders are another strength for this project. They include the State Park and Rec Director Mike Murphy, the Bruce Cameron family who own the land, and the Saxbaugh Chamber of Commerce, to name a few. Some of the weaknesses are the landfill is in a single owner status now. In 2004, when there was some conjecture of privatizing the landfill, there were contracts in place, but now we've done a fantastic job. Greg Thomas is doing wonderful work, compacting better. We own the equipment, so but that does allow it to be sold outright. If a future board doesn't have the vision of this board, then that might be a concern and a weakness. In addition, lack of zoning near the landfill. The landfill siting costs are another weakness. They are continuing to climb, and the number of sites continues to diminish. Saxbaha's growth limits are another weakness, and Saxbaha has a limited ability to absorb an increasing amount of projected tourism. It's a good model we've built, but it's in a constricted location. The threats are that these kinds of projects are less able to be done each year. The costs increase each year for these types of properties. The number of properties are going down. Investors are looking for these large properties. They call them safety deposit boxes with a view. The owner is ready to sell, another threat right now. The company that manages the Cameron property has told me they're ready to sell. We've had some extensive discussions with them, getting them to sell, and now they're ready to sell. The patriarch of that family died about 2 years ago, and they've been in mourning, and they've been putting their family together, and now they're ready to get this property off their books. There's a potential loss of landfill buffer around the landfill, so another threat. Which was brought up in the last 2 years, the buffer issues around the landfill. The Chatham Park tourist inundation is certainly a threat to be considered. This is down in Pittsburgh. As you can see here, the town of Pittsburgh, it's two times larger than Pittsburgh. It's a 7,500-acre, 50,000-person development, which is bordering on the Haw River. It's 12 miles upstream here to where we are at this park. So this forms a particular threat to this project and ecotourism in Saxbaha in general. Opportunities, this is the important part. The big projects comes with high quality partnerships. Those include folks like Elaine Cioso, the riverkeeper, the Haw Riverkeeper downstream, who have recently tangled with Burlington, and they've sued successfully, settled, and they've changed the methods that Burlington uses, so that's a good partner. The Conservation Fund of North Carolina, I've met with the director. We have his buy-in. The president of the Great Outdoor Provision Company, I've met with him and have his buy-in. He helped us extensively put together the Haw River Trail with funding and support. The Haw River Ranch owners, this is a new 300-acre specialty dairy farm and meat cattle farm in Saxbaha that's been put together, and we've got their support. And again, this and finally, there's a multi-county effort that's available here through the backside of the facility into Orange County, so there's good partnerships with Orange County to be made. Ecotourism as a tax revenue source. Currently, Saxbaha is proving that this model of ecotourism is viable in Alamance County on the Haw River. So just to remind you of what you probably already know, the amount of travel expenditures is at a record level now. In 2012, it was $20 billion. This is in the heart of the recession. Domestic tourism is supporting 200,000 jobs across the state. Importantly, $580 million in local tax revenue. I think that's something very important to point out. And then an investment by the state in this type of project, operating budget that brings provides a substantial return to the communities that host these types of projects. The bridgehead, an opportunity to form a bridgehead to Chatham Park. I spoke with Bubba Rawls, the developer down in Chatham Park, and he's excited about working with our county to develop this park. He certainly doesn't want competition right up the river with another 1,000-acre development, I can tell you that. And when I say a bridgehead, as you can see down here, here's the Chatham Park project, Pittsburgh. Here's Chapel Hill. On Friday night, these people are going to be told, you can go here and get a drink in Chapel Hill. You can also be told on Saturday morning, and they will, and you're looking forward to telling people this, go to Saxbaha on Saturday for your activities. And our ecotourism model is working, but we're constrained, as I said. We're at our limit. We can barely handle parking right now. It's a successful model, but success can sometimes kill itself. But this is going to form a nice little triangle here with this park, a nice economic ecotourism triangle. Half of Saxbaha Farmers Market audience over the last 15 years have been the thousands of people that have entered from the triangle. So the triangle is a part of our target audience. Part of the property, and the backside does end up 90 acres of it is in Orange County, so that does give us a backdoor possibility. funding available through the Conservation Fund. Again, I've spoken with Bill Holman. He's the North Carolina director for the fund. He was the Secretary of DENR in 98. He's also the Clean Water Management Trust Fund. He was the director of the Clean Water Management Trust Fund. He's dealt with these $100 million budgets, and he's able to now direct his fund to our cause. What he's waiting on, he's given us his support, but he's waiting on is some movement by the state or by a county. And that doesn't necessarily mean funding, and I put that at the beginning of this proposal, but if we could get the development of the committee to start with, that would show him our support, and the funding could be a promise, which may never happen, and somebody like the Great Outdoor Provision Company might bring in that feasibility study funding. And then it meets as well the goals of the county park and recs. Our mandate in 2003 and the 2020 plan to put in more park and rec, more parks and more trails. And importantly, at the state level, the Park and Recs Director, Mike Murphy, I've met with him, and he said it's a good location for a central park on the Mountains to Sea Trail. It meets the needs for also new park development at the state level. We're having our record visitation levels right now, and as you can see, this part of the state centered on Durham and Chapel Hill is overserved. The population, this is an overserved population with parks and park properties. And when you come to Alamance County, this entire area is devoid of parks. We have a small park the same size as the one we're talking about, Marum Mountain, and we have Haw River State Park at 1,000 acres and Hanging Rock. This area right here would be a great target audience for a new park, and this would fill the gap that's left around this area, which is what they want to see happen. And finally, this establishes firmly for Alamance County as the center of the Mountains to Sea Trail. As this statewide trail moves across the state, it is running into some difficult areas in the center of the state, the most populous and the most developed. From when it was started in the 70s to now, the development has caught them off guard. They've had to change the planned route in the last 10 years. Matter of fact, in 2006, the trail did not go through Saxbaugh, and just in terms of the center, the point about it being the center of the state. If I could take your attention to Jockeys Ridge State Park here, the trail runs along the coast, up the Neuse, across the Piedmont, through the mountains. Most of this is in place. There's these little red areas here which form the parts that are in place, and these are all projected. And in our area right here, if I blow it up, you can see where it's projected. It comes down to Saxbaugh and Cane Creek. Now, the 2006 meeting where we determined the planned route, the folks in Chatham County couldn't make the last of three meetings, and so Hillsborough bent it and brought it up to Hillsborough instead. They lost out down here in Chatham County. So this is the planned route. Establishing Saxbaugh as the center of the trail would help us with our branding, but it would help the state park and recs program as they try to put a park at this location. They planned a park in 2006 when they bent this trail up to Hillsborough, somewhere down in here, and that's exactly where the property lies. So in conclusion, what's the next step? We would like to ask, our board has asked that the county commissioners put together a feasibility study committee. And once that feasibility study committee has put their recommendations in your hands and you've approved them, turn that over to a consultant, and by that time we hope to have pro bono support sufficient to cover the cost of the feasibility study. Run that feasibility study through the consultant, see what comes out, and then task the study committee to implement their findings toward making this park a reality. Now when I say this park, the projected costs that we've come up with are around $10 million for the development of the park, paid for out of the trust fund, partly supported by the state parks, the North Carolina state parks. So part grant money, fund money, nonprofit money, part state money. And we hope that the county then, with that kind of partnership, can maintain control over the management of the park. And our park and recs director has said he's on board with this project as well. So we're looking forward to building a project that he can maintain to develop new jobs for Alamance County, especially in the southern part of the county. So thank you so much for your time. If you have any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Mike. Any questions or comments?
Is the Cameron family, they're selling the property to whomever?
Well, their grandfather died And he was the gentleman who had sold 400 acres of his 1,500 back in 94 for the county landfill.
Yeah, we had to sue him to get it, though.
And so his other 1,100 was effectively landlocked by the, see if this will go back. He was landlocked here by an undetermined border with Orange County at the time, the Haw River. The landfill was here, and there was a one-way dead-end road coming here, no way to get through hundreds of acres of woods here inexpensively. So he couldn't build a development down here because the landfill was a noxious neighbor that people didn't want to drive by to come to a place with houses. But when he passed away, that was 2 years ago, his family was not looking to sell, but we approached them to see if they would be willing to put it on the make it available to the county.
Have they made put a price on it?
They have asked for an appraisal, and I've spoken to the parks director about that. In terms of costs, I would like to have one of our corporate partners pay for the appraisal, and that would give it a third-party aperture.
So what you're asking for tonight is for us to just
consider
it, by appointing a committee. Is that it?
Yeah. Yes, sir. And this first bullet here, convening an oversight committee, this is the most important. But when the conservation fund, when Bill Holman looks at the results of this meeting tonight, and he sees that second bullet is on there, that this was requested and not rejected, and this is, of course, down the road. I want to have funding in place before that ever happens. I don't want to cost a nickel to our overtaxed, challenged community. I want to protect folks' good tax revenue. So this is on there as a lure for the conservation fund to come on. They're on board, but they want to see some support from the county and from the state before they put their money into this.
Dr. Mike, I'm going to suggest that you just continue to stay in contact with our recreation folks and with our manager. And I know we're looking at the possibility of course, and you brought up the Haw River Trail, extending it along that, the right of way there that we need to link that up, and then also maybe some of that property possibly for a bumper for the landfill.
Well, that's a great buffer,
but,
yes.
But other than that, that's something, you know, we'll just let you continue to speak with him, if that's okay, and he can just keep us advised of what's going on.
And Mr. Chairman, that's where staff has been at this point on this project is if the board wants us to pursue a much larger project, we'll be more than happy to. But the immediate need that we see for the county is the additional possibility of buffer area for the landfill.
Yeah.
Again, that's probably one of the best assets that we do have in the county. And Greg, I think, has been working with our engineer on that and trying to see how many acres we would need to adequately have the right buffer. Brian has also been looking at the Mountain to the Sea trail and the issue there. That's where we have been at staff, but if the board is wanting us to, we'll be more than happy to take it a much further than we have at this point. And begin from our endpoint, start looking at grants and options and what we can do to coordinate probably the obtaining of the property without using county dollars. But if that is the direction the board wants us to, it would help us moving forward for putting a little bit of time and effort to it to make sure we have that direction from you.
I would be okay with that. Just out of curiosity, maybe Greg can answer this. I know it's quite a bit of timber on this property.
Yes.
Nice pines.
Yes.
Well, it's maybe that's a potential for helping to do some funding out of that. I don't.
Our estimate's about $1 million of the timber sits on now.
Yeah. So
I think we'd be remiss to pass up an opportunity if we could possibly end up with a really nice park at no cost to us. But I do have a couple of questions. One is, you mentioned hiring a consultant to help do more study feasibility at all. Would that be paid for by somebody else, by one of your corporate partners?
Or? I feel that if we convene an oversight committee and they see that kind of commitment from the county level, from the board, that the fund, the conservation fund, will then go and do the initial first rights of refusal process with the owners and possibly pay for the appraisal as well. Then we would have the land, somewhat protected. Land is extremely at risk right now. This is a sweet spot, an opportunity. Land costs are about to crank up again. It's low, it's flat, it's been flat since 2000, for 15 years. I bought land at high levels in before the recession, $3,000 to $5,000 an acre. They're still running that down on Alamance Creek right now, $3,000 to $5,000 an acre for large parcels. If you can find anything over than 60 or 100 acres, and it's difficult.
Right.
So at this size, 1,100 acres, probably $3,000 an acre to $4,000 an acre.
I don't see any problem with this board saying, yeah, we're interested.
Follow up on it and say,
yeah.
And I don't mind being a.
We're not committing any
on
money.
On the committee, no. If we need a committee with Brian, since I'm on the Park and Rec committee already,
that'd be good.
I'd be more than happy to help.
Would there be ongoing operating costs if this were developed the way you've envisioned it?
Well, we've looked at similar size comparables. Eno River State Park is a good example, 1,000 acres put together by the city in the 70s. They run about a $500,000 a year budget. A military park that's got very low costs, no real facilities, you just walk around, that's about a $300,000 a year budget. And so those are parks like the one at Eno River, where they bring in about 350,000 visitors per year, and it's in a similar market. It's only a distributed market for us. We are looking at the same target audience. So we're looking at 300,000 visitors per year, and we can do a small charge of $1 per person and cover our entire operating costs at that rate. Right. If we let it go completely state park, it's out of your hands, and the state park folks are really excited about getting this land. So if you want to continue management of this property, that's why I think the county should strike now and then do a partnership where you could have somebody else pay for it, but you could then manage it through Brian's office, and you'd have some control over the property in relation to your landfill, which I'm sure is a very
valuable
tool.
Well, the buffer part is definitely a positive.
Let somebody else buy your buffer for you.
Yeah.
I'm sure that as we speak publicly, the knowledge that the land's out there, I see Mr. Ken Bourne sitting there, so as we show interest, you know what that means with the price of the land.
I'm burning my boats here. I'm burning my boats. I've been working on this for 2 years now. In the last year, I've been sitting on my hands waiting for something to happen, and it hadn't. Yeah. So I'm publicly setting fire to my own boats.
Just a consensus from this board then that Dr. Mike worked with our county manager and with Brian with the and the feasibility of maybe having a committee and reporting back to us if that is needed at our next meeting. That would sound.
Well, I think we need to go ahead and say, yeah, we're interested in looking at it.
Yes.
Okay.
I agree.
And that gives us a direction before.
So go ahead and form the committee then.
Yes, sir. If the board, I don't know if we'll have much ready by the next meeting, which is 2 weeks, but we'll try to bring you something as quick as possible.
Yeah, that was pretty direct.
Yes, sir.
2 weeks. So
In these political times,
we will get it to you post-haste.
In these political times, if I could go to Bill Holman and say a bipartisan consensus was espoused about supporting this as we move forward toward a committee, I think that's a phenomenal way to say to him, start your process.
Well, I hadn't heard a single person on the board say no.
I think that's a good idea. And
thanks, sir.
Thanks for bringing that opportunity up.
All right, next we have item 7-4, ECC bond funding, site preparation. Mr. Honeycutt.
I'm going to let our finance officer, Ms. Roberts, handle that.
Susan, Ms. Roberts.
Good evening, Commissioners. Before you in this item is to appropriate $2 million of county funds for the upfront site cost in dealing with the ACC bond. Those monies would be reimbursed back to the county as soon as those bonds are sold. So this just allows us to set up the budget, and if they have any costs between now and before we sell the bonds, then those costs are covered.
This is just part of the $15
million.
That's part
of the $15 million.
Right?
Correct.
Move the project along.
This will move the project
cash flow system.
Yeah.
I think
that was approved, and now we need
Gundar's approved this?
Yes, this was under Gundar's suggestion, is to go ahead and have you approve the $15 million reimbursement resolution, which is the next agenda item, as a formality to do with tax law, and then to also have this on the books as well, stating that the commissioners and the board is approving that the $2 million go ahead and be appropriated, so that if they need to expend it, it's there, but if not, then that just would revert back to fund balance.
All
And just an FYI, I think ACC has spent over $300,000 of their funds at this point. So part of the bond resolution will be to reimburse them as well.
I've got just one question. When this bond is totally funded, what are we looking at as far as tax implication to the county? I read in the paper today that it would be none, but I can't see how you pay bond debt on $15 million without a tax.
I think that's they were going back to what Mr. Manning, I think, was finance officer and judge. You can correct me if I'm wrong. And there had been some bond debt paid off, and so that would have meant that it was pretty much a wash.
Yeah. Is that what I was debt paid off?
And it's going to be about the bond debt for the that $15 million building will be about $1.2 million per year for the next 15 years. Which is, it's a penny on the tax.
Penny on tax, right?
And next fiscal year, I believe we're looking at about $350,000.
We are. Yeah. We're looking at one interest payment. We've talked to Gordon Johnson with the LGC, and we're able to look at just having one interest payment and having that first principal payment be in the 17-18 fiscal year.
Yeah.
Now, let me explain, if y'all don't know, Gundar Zaparans is the bond attorney. Oh, that is one field where you have to be.
You better be smart, right?
I can assure you of that.
What's his name, Gundar?
Gundar Zaparans.
Okay. He is the guru.
We need to keep him on retainer. Okay.
That's one we do need.
For sure. Yes. Right. He is the expert in his field.
Any further questions? No. I'll entertain a motion that we go ahead and loan the community college $2 million to be repaid once the bond is approved.
I have a motion to approve.
And I second it.
Motion to second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Now, you're still there, the bond resolution.
We'll go ahead and do that one as well. At this time, Commissioner Engel, I would ask for you to introduce the resolution, which basically is just the county approving for tax-exempt financing of certain expenditures.
All right. That's not it.
Again, this is from Gundar.
This is from Gundar's. Yes, sir.
Well, Susan, I know I had it laying up here, I thought.
I have it in front of me if you need it.
It was in our packet.
Yeah, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Here you go, Dan.
Thank you.
I got it right here. I got it. Thank you, Bob. Okay. Basically, it's a resolution of the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance, North Carolina, declaring its intention to reimburse the county for the proceeds of one or more tax-exempt financing for certain expenditures in connection with certain capital improvements for Alamance Community College.
Yes, sir.
Let me see, this thing is three pages long, so members, you have it in front of you. It's public record. The press will be delivered copies. I've read the initial first sentence, and so we just need approval of this. Do I have a motion for approval?
Motion to approve.
I have a second.
Second.
All right, motion and second. Any further questions or comments? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you.
I want to just make one comment. I took a tour of Dr. Gatewood last week, and they were real excited getting back in their building that had burned the automotive and the section that had burned down. So they're moving right along down there.
All right, sounds good. Update on A Speedway, item number 6.
Mr. Chairman, I have Libby Hodges, our planning director, talk about the planning board meeting that we had last week.
Welcome.
Good evening. It's going to be real quick.
Yeah. Quicker than our meeting,
like
right?
A lot quicker than the meeting was. It's a marathon meeting.
Yes.
On March 10th, we heard from more than 17 members of the public, which is highly unusual at a planning board meeting, from both sides of the issues. At this time, it appears the homeowners and the management are willing to work together, and we commend them greatly for working together to solve this issue. Staff was directed to provide them with a short draft of the schedule outlined by management at the meeting, and we did that this afternoon. And staff has verified that ACE management has applied for permits that they needed for a new building on the site. and we hope these two groups continue to work together. There were no further ordinance changes recommended at this time.
Please, thank you for a job well done. Please convey our thanks to the planning board also.
I want to thank Rodney personally for his leadership on that thing. He got them together and said, you guys go out in the hall and work this out, and I think they come up with a good agreement that folks can live with out on that on Racetrack Road, and I like the manager. I thought he was very polite in his response to the complainers. So.
Very thorough.
Yes, he was. So, and we even drew Red Justice out of retirement, so he come to speak on behalf of the racetrack. So anybody that follows racing knows Red Justice. So.
Thank you, ma'am. We appreciate that update.
Can I
great
speak?
Work. No, sir.
I spent the time to go up there and be involved in it. I should be able to speak.
Well, you can bring that up at the very first of your three-minute presentation. Thank you. Next, we have the award audit contract, Susan Roberts.
Good evening again.
Thank you, Susan.
You're welcome. Before you tonight is our request and our recommendation to award our audit contract to Martin Starnes and Associates. On November 2nd, we were instructed to issue it out to an RFP, which we did, and we received six bids back on February the 16th. No county audit firms wanted to bid on this, so the staff's recommendation is that we award the audit contract to Martin Starnes based on their qualifications.
Well, I think the last time we did this, they were the lowest bidders on that. So.
I'll have to say, their presentation the last time they came was pitiful, and I was not impressed with them at all. You say no firm in Alamance County even responded?
No, sir.
It seemed like, Judge, it was 100 miles or more away, most of them, but this time, they're from what, Hickory?
Hickory, yes.
Well, their presentation was brief. I mean, I remember asking some questions that I thought they would have covered, and they didn't. But that doesn't mean that the audit itself was bad.
Right. The book was still big.
Well, and if there's an area that you want focused on, I can find out before they come, and then that way they're able to make that presentation more thoroughly.
Yeah. I think their packet that they sent us was very adequate. Yeah. It's just that they didn't cover it in their presentation.
So in terms of the bid, they were low again?
They were not the lowest bid, but when you look at their qualifications in auditing counties, especially of our size and larger, they won on the qualification side.
Any further questions?
Well, from the standpoint, that just makes me ask this question. What's the difference between, what was the range, like, percent-wise, from the lowest to the highest, and where
it was a difference of $5,000.
On how much altogether?
Total cost.
58 is what they are proposing, so it was 53 was the next lowest bid. But the lowest bid did not meet the qualifications.
So they wouldn't have been able to do it because they didn't have the...
The qualifications.
Qualifications. State
how many counties is Martin Starnes one now?
They are auditing 37 counties and municipalities as well. So when you look at their qualifications to thoroughly do a county is audit, especially one of our size, they're ranked first on qualifications. Like I said, there was a $5,000 difference there between the next lowest one. The next lowest one, they only had one other bigger county that would compare to us. Everything else was smaller.
Any further questions? Entertain a motion that approval of the recommendation that Susan has.
I'll make the motion.
Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
All right. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no?
No.
All right. Thank you. All right, that leaves us with one more proclamation.
Oh, the Commerce Park.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, you're fine. I was about to leave you out. Go ahead.
Max over there.
Go ahead. Mac Williams said, let you sit here all night and then forget you.
Right.
I'm sorry. Come on up, sir.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I did want to introduce Mac Williams, who's president of the Alamance County Chamber of Commerce and our Economic Development Director. One of the issues that we had at our last meeting was when we did some expenditures for the improvement of the roadway at the North Carolina Commerce Park, you wanted to know where we were at, what's going on, and so it was a good time to bring Mac in, kind of talk about where the park is, next steps, and so we had Mac come in, and we appreciate your time.
Thank you, Mr. Manager, and members of the board. I'm delighted to be here to give you an update on the North Carolina Commerce Park, which you guys, with your counterparts in Graham and Mevin, have made happen with your previous actions. If someone will handle the lights, please. I do have an aerial photograph up here that I want to use as a, I guess go ahead and turn them all off. The photograph is very difficult to see. Is that a little better?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And I'm sorry I don't have a pointer with me to highlight areas while I'm discussing. May I step over and talk louder?
Sure.
Yeah, if I can do that.
Oh,
watch out.
Thank you.
I see that.
Here's your pointer. Oh, he's got a pointer right there.
Okay, well, I'll have to look twice. Thank you so much. Just as orientation, here's the interstates, 85 and 40, going east-west, north-south. This is Hallfield Trollingwood Road and exit 152. This is exit 150 and ACC. This is Cherry Lane here. This is 119 going down this way and over to Mevin, and this is Kimry Road. And so that's this outlined area is roughly 1,100 acres. And the reason, again, that area has been identified in that way is because when the water and when the sewer line was put in to serve the Walmart facility, with the pump station being back over in this area from Graham, all of this area inside of this line was more or less made available for gravity flow sewer. So that sewer installation opened up for possible development using gravity flow to the sewer system, this 1,100 acre area. So that's why it's defined that way. And the county and the cities identified this as an economic development zone. And so from there, Walmart got located to serve Walmart. You can see, and I apologize for the delineation here, but there's a new road that's being put in that roughly follows this track right here, and it ended right here. The state of North Carolina DOT put that road in as part of the incentive package to help Walmart get in there. So we were happily going along meeting our requirement to serve the Walmart project when a year or two later, Lidl came looking for a site. And the process was successful in attracting Lidl, who wanted the same kinds of benefits that Walmart did. They needed a large site. They needed one that was more or less ready to go, which this one was in terms of the water and sewer anyway. And importantly, the road, the continuation of the road from here all the way over to here was already permitted. We hadn't decided to build it yet, but we could prove to them that it was already permitted. And so there wasn't going to be a time issue having to wait for the state to permit or not the extension of what is now called Senator Ralph Scott Parkway. And so with that and some more work with DOT, a commitment to improve Governor Scott Farm Road, which is currently a gravel road. There's going to be a commitment on the part of DOT to pave that road, and that should get underway this summer. So by the time, let's call it by the end of the summer,
we should have the Senator Ralph Scott Parkway completed to Governor Scott Farm Road, and hopefully Governor Scott Farm Road improved. And so with that, with all the water and the sewer lines in, all of the interior road work, or at least the major interior road work completed, the work out here at the entrance, which you approved some funding for at your last meeting, the majority of the hard infrastructure work should be done for the majority of those parcels out there. Now, there's going to be issues as we serve each individual parcel in here. You have some extensions. You have to cross over the creek to get over to the north side. You know, there might be some more road jut outs to have to be done to serve individual parcels, but the backbone of the park or of the zone should be in more or less in place. Now, once the zone got serviced, then the next thing is, okay, well, what do we do next? And this became a question about how do we market it, how do we position it out in the market so that we can continue to attract tax base and job creation projects like Walmart and Lidl, which together represent announced investments of over $200 million to the tax base, and between the two of them going to be about 600 jobs if they build out as was announced at the time they announced. So that's a pretty good start to a industrial area. So importantly, as you may recall, the ownership of all the land remains with the landowners. None of the local governments have bought anything in advance or to sit on it, and where the governmental entities are the developers. The landowners still own the land, right, and control the decisions about what to do with it. So the local governments got together and authorized us, that the chamber, me, to go out into the market and hire some assistants to take the development steps forward about marketing, about getting control of some of the land so that we can start to be more proactive at positioning this area to be successful in attracting companies. And after a process for finding qualified assistants, Samet Corporation was selected to be the developer with which we would go forward on site certification work. And there was money appropriated for that purpose, for that and for marketing purposes and other things. And so we selected Samet, and Samet and I started going and speaking with and meeting individually with all the property owners in here to see if they would sign up, if you will, and provide options to Samet for moving forward, and Samet would do site certification and marketing and all these other things at their expense, not at our expense, to move forward. So at this point, and we met with everybody, and they were all very cordial. They were very interested, as you can imagine. Some of the owners they're not local. Some of them are. They're very local. The land's been in the family for a long time. It's an emotional thing. It's a tax thing. So lots of different issues that different family members need to address and be comfortable with. And so at this point, without getting specific about which parcels, I can tell you that several hundred acres are under option with Samet, signed agreements. We are pursuing the site certification work on those acres that are under option. We've started with there's a lot to those certification processes. A lot of that work is lengthy. Title searches, for example, are part of what has to be done. Environmental work, to assessments to be done. And so Samet will start those things. I would expect that all that work to be done certainly by the end of the year. In addition, Samet and I have moved forward with a local marketing firm to develop a kind of a logo and a tagline that we can use on marketing materials, because we are starting now to present NC Commerce Park to projects and prospects as they come in, and we want to add more
I guess, finish and polish to our presentation of the area. We're calling it North Carolina Commerce Park, but we're just trying to add some marketing sizzle, I guess, to the steak by dressing it up and making it look more professional in our presentation. So that's underway. I'm trying to think of what else. By the way, as these things happen, many of the things I've just told you, as all these things happen, from time to time, it's not on any regular basis, but from time to time, I will send out an email to all the landowners. I've got a distribution list. We've tried to be very transparent in all of this. We've tried to be very direct and open about how we're moving forward and how decisions are being made and who's going to do what, and trying to keep all these landowners informed about how we're moving forward, to keep them engaged. And as time moves on and some of them want to move into the situation with Samet, then that door certainly is still open. However, we have one situation where the landowner is going to move forward in a similar way to what Samet is doing, but they're going to do it themselves with another developer with which they have a history and that with whom they're more comfortable. So we will still use the North Carolina Commerce Park identifier and logo and everything for the whole zone, but Samet will do it with their stuff, and this other person will do it with their stuff, and if another landowner wants to get yet another developer in there, I guess that's their option. It's going to be more confusing, but again, as I said, a key to the development of this whole area is that for the most part, the landowners still control how this land is going to be developed over time. And it's messier than it would be if local governments or a private sector developer came in and just negotiated the whole thing. That'd be a lot cleaner. But that's where we are at the moment. Another thing that's going on at the moment, it's an interesting aspect to this, is the zoning issue. As you know, right now, when this area was looked at for automotive plants way back in the 90s, this which preceded my time here, but I've heard all about it and was followed a little bit. Basically, the city of Mebane and the city of Graham split this whole area almost pretty much in half. In fact, this property line between Lidl and Walmart is the dividing line, roughly, of where Mebane's jurisdiction is all up in here and Graham's jurisdiction is up in here. And so they agreed on water and sewer service, they agreed on zoning, they agreed on all kinds of things. Well, now that this partnership has taken place, there is conversation among Mebane and Graham about creating a zoning classification that would apply to all of the zones. So a single zoning classification for the whole area, so that if somebody comes in there, let's say they're looking at three places. Let's say they're looking over here, maybe over here, and maybe up in here. Well, so that would be, rather than having to deal with two different zoning classifications, we could tell them, well, there's a single classification no matter where in here you go. And so that's an interesting aspect in the sense that it continues the cooperative nature of this park, and it shows the prospect, it shows the landowners, it shows citizens that you do have cooperative effort between governmental entities here in a very important and substantial way. So that the discussion about that zoning classification is in process. No decisions have been made. A rough draft perhaps may be out there and still working on it and tweaking it. But if and when the time comes that such a thing might occur, I guess all three, even though you guys aren't in the zoning business, all three entities would need to understand it. Because there's a part of this park out here, I think, that's in the county that's not zoned. Correct? If that serves me right.
Right. This is outside of everybody's.
And I want to end. You can, if you want to take the light back on, I know my time is short, but I just want to end by saying that all of this work is exciting. It's taking a while, which is not unusual, but we're moving forward. The park has gotten some very interesting press because of the unique nature of the team that worked to put it together. This magazine, North Carolina Economic Development issue, comes out every year, and it's published by Business North Carolina, and they use it as a marketing tool, the state does, for what they do. So they add it in a marketing package or have it laying around, you know, different places. And in our park here, the North Carolina Commerce Park of the Zone, was a feature article in one of the articles in this particular issue of the magazine. So we've gotten a lot of attention, I think. We weren't the first one to do a multi-jurisdictional effort, won't be the last one. But ours came along as kind of a unique way, I think, because it got Walmart and Lidl fairly quickly and close together was what brought the attention to it, because those are two worldwide known names. So we're excited about the inventory opportunities this area provides us, in addition to the other places in the county that also are available. We've got a good mix of parcels in different places with different levels of utility services and access, and what you need is variety. And so this certainly adds to that. And we're moving forward in a way that I think we keep the local governments through their managers informed on a regular basis, including the landowners as well. So we hope we're doing what you would have hoped we would be doing, and continuing to present this park and this area in a way that hopefully can continue to generate tax base and jobs.
Thank you.
Questions? Matt, I just got one question about this whole area in there. I was out on 119, and I've talked to people in the Hallfields area, and it's just been, it's such a congestion there on where the road comes into 119.
Yes.
Has there been any conversation with the state of possibly putting the loop over there where the Cherry Lane runs across the interstate?
You mean another interstate interchange?
Yeah, because I can see in the future with the growth that's coming around Alexander Wilson and Honda over there. I mean, it's just chaos, taking people an hour in the morning sometime to get through the stoplight 119 going into Madden.
Well, I will tell you that the congestion there at the church, at Hallfields Church Road and 119, was there before Walmart showed up.
Right. I'm not saying this caused it.
Well, and what my point is that the new road that got put into the Commerce Park was done because the site selection consultant for Walmart, when I took him from the Hallfields Church where I met him to the site via 119, and not only the traffic, but you have a daycare, the retirement home, some neighborhoods, he said, if this is your best way to go, we're done.
Well, it's the
certainly the congestion in that area is going to be an ongoing issue that will some have to be addressed. At the moment, I'm not aware of longer range plans to address Hallfields Trollingwood Road or that interchange or Cherry Lane interchange. I'm not aware of it. If it's going on, we aren't engaged in depth conversations in any way.
I just looked at this whole
area. So certainly as the Walmart and Lidl trucks start to get out on Hallfields Road and onto that one exit 152, and the Love's
new truck stop
on the other side continues to develop and have traffic, generate traffic. There are mornings on NC at exit 150. There are times of day at where the three back truck up stops and the ACC traffic starts to get backed up there as well. So not just that interchange, but probably a couple of them probably ought to get on somebody's planning radar screen.
I know you do work with the Department of Commerce at the state. And when you look at these things, and when the governor drives in, take him by Hallfields Church in the morning one day and let him see how congested, and maybe know what we need.
No question.
Lidl's going to take Governor Scott back to Cherry Lane, mm-hmm. and then a left, and if they made a right, I mean, they'd be right there at the interstate.
Right.
It just makes sense if you had an exchange there, interstate.
And I know
bring it back around 119.
I don't have the answer for that at the moment.
And the time
it takes to get to get a new interchange on the system and approved, and to get the permitting and the environmental studies and the traffic studies and the funding and all that, we got to start now.
Plant it in somebody's head to get that started.
So that's where all that is. So I hope to have, since I'm not a resident of that immediate area, I really, it wouldn't sound right for me saying what I'm going to say, but, you know, but the economic developer in me hopes that we have that problem of where, you know, we need to go out to that next layer of access and road work and other things to make that whole area as serviceable as it needs to be to account for not just new stuff coming in, but the people already there, making it more livable and manageable from a growth standpoint.
And I got one question. Lidl is 20 acres under roof. Is that correct? I've heard that.
Is it 950,000 square feet?
Yeah. About 20 acres. I mean, if you look at that map, it looks like a little building, but you think about that. That's a lot of concrete and building.
Yeah, the Walmart design, I think, shows the potential for a second. The Walmart building's a 500,000 square feet, and I think that graphic there shows how a second 500,000 square foot would be added at some point. But that's not the way the current facility is going to look at the moment.
I was talking to Mr. Chandler from Chandler Concrete. They kept them very busy.
Yeah, they had to put a temporary plant across the street from both of them because Chandler's pouring the concrete for both places. That's right. Yeah. So thank you for letting me thank you on behalf of the other partners for your foresight and your participation early on to make the zone happen. And hopefully you're getting the payback in jobs and tax base that was hoped for.
Thank you, Matt. Thank
any,
you,
any other questions?
No, we're good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All right. Next, we have a proclamation for National County Government Month that I have here before me. And by consensus, asked for approval, and I'll read this. It's not as long as the other one. Proclamation 2016 National County Government Month, Safe and Secure Counties. Whereas the nation's 3,069 counties, serving more than 3 million Americans, provide essential service to create healthy, safe, vibrant, economically resilient counties. And whereas Alamance County and all counties take pride in the responsibility to protect and enhance the health, well-being, and safety of our residents in efficient and cost-effective ways. And whereas through National Association of Counties, President Sally Clark's Safe and Secure Counties Initiative, NACO is encouraging counties to focus on strengthening the safety and security of their communities. Whereas in order to remain healthy, vibrant, safe, and economically competitive, America's counties provide public health, justice, emergency management, and economic services that play a key role in everything from residents' daily health to disaster response. Whereas each year since 1991, National Association of Counties has encouraged counties across the country to actively promote programs and service to the public we serve. And whereas Alamance County Government will promote National County Government Month by inviting and encouraging citizens to participate in County Government 101 to learn more about the vital role counties play in communities. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim April of 2016 as National County Government Month and encourage all county officials, employees, schools, and residents to participate in county government celebration activities. 21st day of March, Dan Engel, Chairman, Tory Frank, Clerk to the Board. Thank you, Jerry.
Mr. Chairman, yes, also, we have a small video that we want to show you, and then I've got a couple statements after that.
All right, sir.
This is associated with National County Government Month.
All right, sir.
Terry.
Yeah, really. And I want to thank Scott Ward for getting that together, and I also want to thank Tori Frank, our county clerk. Tori has been very instrumental. One of the things that we've talked about for years, at least since I've been here, and something Tori has really pushed for us to do, is to have introductory to County Government 101. And the Sheriff Department has a Sheriff's Department Academy. This is not going to be the in-depthness as a Sheriff's Department Academy at this point, but we thought we would try it in celebration of County Government Month. And so the thought process is we would have two sessions, one during the day and one at the evening, two 1.5-hour sessions. And we'll talk about organizational structure, we'll talk about funding, we'll talk about intergovernmental relationships, economic development. But either you can do this April 5th and 7th from 2 p.m. to 3 p.m. here at the county offices, or we'll do it April 11th or 14th from 5:30 to 6:30. So again, just kind of County Government 101, and something we just wanted to try in respect to and promoting County Government Month. And again, thanks to Tori for all her work on this as well.
Thank you, Tori. Thank you, Mr. County Manager. Mm-hmm. All right, Mr. Honeycutt, County Manager.
The only couple things that I do have, Libby's got real short. We've had 17 strategic plan forms. I'll let her give the quick update on that.
Come back up here again. My voice doesn't carry very well today. We're going to have our last meeting on the 23rd. I guess I should say this relating to the strategic plan. This is a general update. But our last meeting is going to be the 23rd at the Realtors Association. They put that together for us, so we appreciate their efforts. Susan Osborne, I'd like to thank her and her group because we forwarded a giant stack of information to Karen Collins' group for data entry. So we're working very hard to get that all put together and get that back out to you. We're still in the process for the naming contest. We've had a couple of responses. I put together a Survey Monkey survey, which is online through email. If you'd like a paper copy, just let me know. But we're moving forward with that, with Commissioner Byrd as well. As mentioned, we're going to start coming up with some dates for the Commissioners Forum to present our findings. We will also be working with some of the community groups in case they want us to come back out and present this information as well. So I did hear some interest while we were out there. They want to make sure they stay in the loop. And we've tried to keep, well, we haven't tried to keep, we have a sign-in sheet that everyone filled out while we were doing our forums that we have emails of many of the participants. So. Do you have any particular questions?
What's total participants today? I know you've been keeping
I don't have a final number. My guess is 150 maybe people. And that's just a thumb guess. A thumbnail guess. I haven't.
Yeah.
They range at from least just a few to 20 or 30.
Right. Yeah, we've had everything from 3-4 people come up, and those were actually some really great conversations. We could get a lot more in depth. All the way to 30 people. And we do have a map that we asked everyone who attended to put a dot on the map to show where they were coming from to try to visually represent that we're getting a good spread of people coming out.
Yep. Sounds good.
Right. Very good.
Any questions? Well, thank you. Thank you, Dave.
Thanks, Dave. And the last thing I do have, Mr. Chairman, is it's time to begin setting up our budget workshops.
Mm-hmm.
What we are looking at is tentative the weeks of April 11th and April 18th. We're looking at, in doing the outside agencies as well, we're thinking 5 to 6 sessions. That's the reason why we wanted to do it over a 2-week period, looking anywhere from 2 to 3 hours. But I remember Commissioner Boswell said mornings was not a good time for him, so we were looking into afternoons of those 2 weeks. So if you have dates that are not good, you can let us know in the next couple of days. But again, the weeks of 11th and the 18th of April. And then if once I get the dates that are not good, we can formulate a schedule and let you know the final schedule from that, if that's agreeable to the board, instead of trying to pull out calendars now.
Sounds good. All right, any other comments, Craig? That
you no, sir.
All right, commissioners' comments.
Don't have any.
Well, following up on what Libby just presented about the naming contest, mm-hmm. Libby, how many entries were there? There were like 25 or something, I think. Maybe more.
25 sounds right.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
And so what Libby had done was to send us an email with a link to that Survey Monkey. Rank order your top selections of those, and then if they kind of, it takes you about, you know, maybe 5 minutes to, I had to think, because there were so many good ones. So it took me a little while to figure out which ones I like the best. But and then you'll collate those and come back with the top ones, and then we can talk about. Because there's prize money associated with this, right?
Yes. And people are very, very eager to hear.
Joe, did you pitch over here?
All right. Further comments, commissioners? Hearing none, meeting adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.